Thanks for joining me again for another episode of Exploring Israel for Bible Study. I'm Jeff Baxter. I'm the next generation pastor at Mission Hills Church in Littleton, Colorado. So excited to be here with you today. My wife and I love leading trips to Israel, and the place and the people we're going to talk about today are probably the most significant. It's Golgotha and the Garden Tomb, and whether Jesus even rose from Well, Golgotha and the Garden Tomb are probably the most significant places in all of Israel, especially Jerusalem. These are believed to be the places where Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection took place. Now, there's another site, the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, that's believed to be this spot as well. But I want to show you the evidence around this place to see if this is the place where actually Jesus died and he actually rose from the grave. But first, let's talk about, did Jesus even rise from the grave at all? Did it really happen? Well, there are three truths that everybody needs to wrestle with, whether you believe the resurrection today or you don't, and maybe you're on this YouTube channel just exploring this. Well, number one, the tomb in which Jesus was buried was discovered empty by a group of women on that Sunday morning following the crucifixion. It's just true. The Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John all declare. There's extra biblical evidence that also points to them coming to the tomb and visiting, and it was empty. Number two, Jesus' disciples had real experiences with the one who rose from the grave, Jesus. After he rose, after he's crucified, after he rose from the grave, they had personal encounters with him over a 40-day period to 500 at once at one time. Number three, as a result of preaching this message that Jesus was alive, the Church of Jesus Christ has launched throughout the world and continues to do so today, all because of this one event. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the four gospel writers, declare that Jesus appeared after he rose from the grave. Even Paul, who wrote half of the New Testament of the Bible, declared it in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 3 through 8. Paul records this ancient creed. Here's what he says. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12, after he had appeared to more than 500 people at once. So he appeared to individuals and to groups over 40 days after he rose from the grave. The resurrection proves a few things. If Jesus rose from the grave, you can trust him. You can trust him with your whole life. Number one, you can believe Jesus' words are true about himself. He said he was God. He said he was God. He said in several phrases connecting him to the Old Testament prophecies, he said, I am, many times, which connected him to that event with Moses of the burning bush back in the Old Testament, declaring he was God. He said he was the Son of Man. He used that title. He declared that he was the one. When he was asked, even in the legal trials in the middle of the night, Jesus said that what you're saying is true. I am the king. I am the king of the Jews, and I'm the king of the whole world. Number two, you can believe that the Bible is true if Jesus rose from the grave. Not only just Jesus' words in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but you can also prove, you can believe in the whole Bible is true. Number three, you can believe that Jesus is the one and only way to have your sins forgiven. If Jesus rose from the grave, then it proves that he died on a cross, a brutal crucifixion on a Roman cross. Then he rose from the grave. Your sins can be forgiven because he was God who died in your place. You can believe that. Number four, you can believe Jesus will judge the world one day. He rose from the grave. No other world leader has ever done that. Muhammad, Confucius, Buddha, none of them have risen from the grave. Jesus did. So he can judge the whole world, and he will one day. Number five, you can believe in life after death, eternal life. Because he rose from the grave, we too are going to rise from the grave for eternity, for eternal life, to go to a place called heaven to be with God. Now let's talk about the locations of Golgotha and the Garden Tomb today. What are these places all about? What's the evidence for them being the place where Jesus actually died on a cross and actually rose from the grave? Well, get your Bible ready. Let's turn to a few passages. John chapter 19, verse 16 says this, "So the soldiers took charge of Jesus, carrying his own cross. He went out to the place of the skull, in Aramaic, which means Golgotha." So this place was discovered in 1871. There were several European scholars and archaeologists who came, and they saw the image of the skull in the side of the mountain, and they thought this could be the place, Golgotha, because it was unique. These cave-like holes for the eyes, and it looked like a nose, and the nose has since fallen off since they saw it, but it looked distinctly like a skull, which is what the Bible says it would have been. And then in 1883, a British Major General, Charles George Gordon, identified this place, and he found the tomb a stone's throw away from where Golgotha is, outside the city walls. And he said, this is the Garden Tomb. This is Golgotha. This is the Garden Tomb where Jesus was laid and rose from the grave. It's just outside the city walls, just outside the Damascus Gate, northern Jerusalem. There's this popular site right there that's believed to be the place where Jesus died on the cross and rose from the grave. In John chapter 19, verse 41, at the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden. In the garden, a new tomb in which no one had been laid. This is really important. There's a garden discovered where the tomb is that no one had been laid. How do we know it was a garden? Because we're going to discover there's a wine press there, which points to the owner being rich and wealthy. So Gordon, discovering this place near the skull, near the tomb, discovered the garden. This region of called Gordon's Calvary, Skull Hill at Northern, is just outside. And it's the same place off right where Mount Moriah is, where the Dome of the Rock is. And that would be prophesied all the way back to Leviticus chapter 1, and all the way back to when Abraham would bring Isaac to be sacrificed on that, and God would provide a substitute. And now Jesus is our substitute. This is the same region that God was foreshadowing that this image and this event would take place, where Jesus would come die for our sins. This is the region, and the tomb is also outside the city gate, which is confirmed in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 12. And so Jesus also suffered outside the city gate to make the people holy through his blood. We know it was outside the city gate. You can look at the walls today. In this region, there's a cliff, the skull. Matthew chapter 27, verse 33, they came to the place called Golgotha, which is the place of the skull. Now, there was a wealthy man. It was his tomb, we know from the Bible. And the tomb was carved out of the rock, and there was a garden in the tomb. The garden was there, and there's a wine press that's been discovered. You can see it today. In Matthew chapter 27, verse 57, as evening approached, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. We know that this tomb was rushed a little bit to make it a little bit longer because Sabbath was coming. So the seal of the tomb had to be placed there, the seal meaning the guard, the Roman guard. Well, there's physical evidence, archaeological evidence of a seal placed there, right where the guard would have been. Matthew chapter 27, verse 65. "Take the guard," Pilate answered. "Go make the tomb as secure as you know how." So they went and made the tomb secure by putting a seal on the stone and posting the guard. That's to make sure the stone cannot move. You can look at where that was on the wall at the garden tomb. There's been chemical analysis done at this site that points to not having any decay of a body, which would only affirm a resurrection. There's been graffiti found that was scratched in the wall that says Alpha and Omega, which only points to there being, well, a really important person in this tomb. And there's evidence that the tomb was hurriedly put together and hurriedly put carved out so that no one had ever been in it before. And we know that the size would have been someone who was about 5'11" to be able to lay down in there. There's only one explanation for that. There's also a great stone we know from the Bible that was placed there and rolled in front that would have been a little bit larger than normal, actually, because of the size of the groove that you can see there, about 15 inches wide, and the size of the diameter of the rock would have been huge. We don't know where the stone is today, but we know the evidence of a stone that was there rolled in front. So why is this important? Because when the women came to the tomb, they knew that they weren't going to be able to roll it away. They didn't know, how are we going to get the stone out of the way if we're going to try and go in and prepare Jesus' body with, add some spices to it and honor him in that way? Well, when they arrived, an angel had rolled the rock out of the way and was sitting on it, the Bible says. They were on their way in the tomb, and they asked each other, who's going to roll away the stone from the entrance of the tomb? Mark chapter 16, verse 2. And they showed up, and it was rolled out of the way. Well, this evidence doesn't make it absolutely certain that Golgotha and the Garden Tomb are the place that Jesus died and rose from the grave. But regardless, it does point to a place, and the historical evidence that Jesus rose from the grave is overwhelming today. It's a historical fact of history with archaeological evidence and prophecy fulfilled. So I pray that you place your trust in Jesus, who can forgive your sins, who's alive today and wants a relationship with us. Well, thanks for exploring.